Thank you all for being here this evening. So what we're doing is we're having this evening a conversation on Islam. We've heard some rhetoric, you know, during any political season, there's certain rhetoric. And the rhetoric seemed to be especially high this last campaign cycle against certain groups of people, including immigrants, which is why we invited in an immigration lawyer 2 weeks ago, and including Muslims. The word that we've heard a lot lately is Islamophobia. We know that phobia means a fear of something. So what is Islamophobia? A fear of? A fear of Islam or a fear of Muslims. So interestingly, as we were just kicking this off, before I introduce our speakers, you know, we were talking with one another about what we know about Islam. And I suggested, Buddha asked me how many Muslim friends I have. My response was, quite a few, but I bet more than I know. Because that is to say, sometimes we don't ask people what religion they are. We'll be interacting with all sorts of people. And for instance, Amanda, as part of this introduction, she said, would you know that I'm Muslim if I didn't tell you? I mean, it's sort of like, we have certain stereotypes, certain images, and people may or may not fit with those stereotypes, those ideas that we have in our heads. So that's why I thought it best simply for us to invite in friends from the Muslim community to be able to help to educate us about Islam, about Muslims in the world. Did you know that Islam is the world's second largest religion, I understand? Correct me if I'm wrong. I'd like to understand that Islam has about 1.6 billion adherents in this world, which means that roughly 23%, or one out of every four people on this earth, self-identifies as Muslim. By the year 2050, Muslims will grow in number, according to Pew Research Center, will grow in number to almost be as numerous as Christians, which currently Christians are the largest religion in the world. Muslims, right up there with us. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our speakers this evening, and maybe ask them to introduce themselves as well. Amanda and I actually go back maybe 15 years. Amanda and I were both serving on the board of directors of the Austin Area Interreligious Ministries together. Today they're known as IACT, which means
Interfaith Action of Central Texas.
There you go.
She's on board now.
Oh, how awesome. So I was going off the board when Amanda was coming on to the board, so we didn't know one another much back then, but it just so happened that maybe 2 weeks ago, I was at another board meeting, and a young lady came up to me afterward and said, my name is Amanda, do you remember me? And I said, no way. So Amanda, and she brought along her friend Muna, who is now a member of the board of directors of IACT, which stands for Interfaith Action of Central Texas.
Give them a round of applause.
So without further ado, I'll turn it over to you all to lead us in conversation.
Okay, so I think we can just say a couple things, a few words about Islam and our own personal practice, and then open it up for questions, because I think that's usually the most fun and enjoyable, and we don't want you to be bored and just listen to us talk, and hopefully we would love it if you left with some information that you actually want. So, yes, Father Jamie is correct. Islam is the second largest religion in the world. Most people have in their heads one idea of what a Muslim looks like.
I'd like to introduce you.
Oh.
More than Father Jamie, Father Ray. Yes. Yes, because I think it's important for people to know who they're talking to in more detail. So I met Amanda 13 years ago. So you've known Amanda longer than me. Amanda is actually married to a guy we have a mutual friend. So I've actually known of her husband before they were married. And we go back almost 20 years, and Amanda, you used to be what? Catholic?
So I was baptized Catholic, but then my parents converted when I was about one, and I was raised as a Jehovah's Witness until about 18 or 19. I left that and ended up converting 5 or 6 years later.
26 now. And Amanda is a communications guru, right? Social media, blogging, Facebook, Twitter, you name it, she knows it. So if you need a consultant, this is your person. I go to her for all my, I don't know what to do. Help me. And then she always saves everything. Amanda has two kids, a boy and a girl, they're twins. And Amanda also has a potty mouth.
And she's also a very powerful community organizer and has been for as long as I know her. She does a lot just trying to get people on the same page in our community. She also works with the hate crimes task force for the city of Austin and works with a lot of those other groups on the task force to help our community, to protect ourselves, to figure out what we can do when hate crimes happen. She tries to build coalitions and is really sort of a point person and a visible figure in the Muslim community. You'll see her often on television or being interviewed or speaking at City Hall because she's usually the one, she maintains great relationships with the Austin Police Department and the mayor's office, and she's a great person.
I should have her introduced. You need to go with me.
So if I can go back to
where
I was, yeah, so yes, Islam is the second largest religion in the world, but most people are very surprised. They have in their heads one view of what a Muslim is, looks like, sounds like, does. In reality, the country with the largest amount of Muslims is Indonesia, which is an Asian country. The second largest is Pakistan, which is actually not in the Middle East, contrary to popular belief. It is also an Asian country. And there are actually more Muslims, Chinese Muslims, who are ethnically Chinese, than there are in Saudi Arabia. So Islam is a huge, diverse religion. And in the same way Father Jimmy was explaining to us beforehand, where you guys sit in relation to Catholicism, Roman Catholicism. In the same way, in Islam, there are all kinds of sects and groups and offshoots and interesting variations, some of which are based with culture and some of which are based in location. So it's really, really, really hard to say this is what a Muslim looks like and this is what a Muslim does, right? If you know anything about Muslims. If you don't know anything about Muslims, you have one idea, and that's pretty much what you see on the news all the time, which is usually somebody who's very angry and has a beard. So,
except for when I'm giving an interview.
Yes. No, I'm
sorry. I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
But one of the things that we do, like Muna and I do regularly, is go out and talk to communities because we want people to understand the diversity in our community. Austin has an incredibly diverse Muslim community. There's about 20,000 Muslims here, and I think there's about 70 different countries represented. So we have Muslims from Africa, from Asia, every continent. We have white Muslim converts, we have white Muslims that are from the Balkans, we have Muslims from everywhere, Turkish, whatever. And you don't always know that people are Muslims, sometimes you do. Sometimes people, you know, want to put Muslims in political, on a political continuum based on how they look. But I will tell you, some of the most progressive and liberal Muslim women I know wear a headscarf, And some of the most conservative Muslim women I know don't. So it's really, really, really hard, even for us, and we do it to ourselves. I think we sometimes try to, you know, label ourselves and label each other, and that's, we're doing ourselves a disservice when we do that. So part of what we do on a regular basis, voluntarily, is just go out and talk to people, because we want people to understand who we are, where we're coming from, and that there really isn't a single way to define us as people. There's a few, maybe a handful of tenets and practices that I think every single Muslim in the world probably subscribes to. And even then, maybe not. So I'll let you say a few words.
If I'm yawning, it's not because I'm bored. I have a 10-month-old. So don't take my yawning personally.
Thanks.
I think the other thing I would say is just take what we say with a grain of salt, because what we're sharing is our opinion. And you'll even, you know, maybe I'll say something that Amanda disagrees with, or vice versa, right? And so just know that we're one or two of 1.8 billion, right? And we hope that you guys will have fun with us today, and we're not just here to give you a speech. And really, no question is off limits. Do not worry about being politically correct. I tell you personally this, you cannot offend either of us. And we would much rather you have answers to your questions from us than other sources out there, because a lot of information that's out there is not correct. It's just not. I'm actually appalled by a lot of the information that is propagated by real news channels. So don't be shy. We are more than happy to answer your questions, no matter what they are.
Do you mind if I start with the first question?
Go ahead.
So, the question is, what do different religions believe, right? It seems that we as Christians have this belief that Jesus was the Christ, and we're even aware of some of the challenges that come with that belief. On Sunday, for instance, during our homily, you know, we talked about how it was that Mark had a very different view of Jesus, a lower view, a view that Jesus was crazy, right? So we have different views of Jesus, say between Mark and Matthew, we have different views. But as Christians, we believe certain things. What is it, could you summarize, you talk about tenets, maybe some of this heard of various pillars of Islam, like what are some of those things that many, if not most Muslims, would believe, and so that we have to understand how it is different from Christianity? Do y'all believe, for instance, that Jesus is the Christ? I'm imagining Jesus has a different role in Islam.
Yes. So I think that, like, the core, if you could, if there was nothing else that anyone agreed on, the core central tenet of Islam is this thing called Tawhid, which is that God is one, right? And so because of that is the, that, and so that's instantly the thing that separates us from Christianity, is that we don't believe in a Trinity. We don't believe that God has any partners. We don't believe in a pantheon of God. We believe that there's a single entity that's God. And that is it. And because of that, because we try to, there's a radical monotheism, we tend to shun any kind of representation of God. Right, and so that's why you never see pictures. We don't even do pictures of Muhammad, much less God. Right, we don't do any kind of icons or anything like that. Most of the arts and things that you see in Islam are going to be like Arabic script, right, writing pieces of the Quran or things like that, which is done beautifully. It's art, but we don't. We view God as something above, far above anything that we can actually visualize or grasp, and certainly nothing that could be represented here on Earth in any form or fashion. So I think that's just like the, right out the gate, that's going to be the thing that's going to separate Islam from Christianity. And then there's several other things that we kind of flesh out as far as our practice and stuff, but those are things that we may actually have in common, things like charity, was one of the major pillars of Islam. We have five that we consider kind of incumbent on everybody, daily prayers. We are responsible for five daily prayers, and I was actually amazed when I used to work at Mobile Loaves and Fishes. Do you know Mobile Loaves and Fishes? Yeah, and so it was founded in a Catholic church, and the director and I had some really fascinating conversations. And there's actually, I didn't realize, like in Catholic tradition, there's actually five daily prayers, right? Sort of the, I don't know what it's called, but what do you call it? Like every day, they have like a book.
Right, we come at our divine office. We've talked about this before, how the monks used to pray eight times a day, actually.
Okay.
And then the church sort of scaled it back, so eight times a day was a little burden. Five times? No.
Okay. Yeah, the guy I used to refer was a Catholic deacon. He was my boss, and he had like a little book, and it had like these different times of the day. And obviously nobody still does that, except for really hardcore people. But but it was interesting to me to know that that was actually a similarity. Nevertheless, prayer is a part of, however many times you do it, a part of the daily devotional life of anybody who's worshiping God. So prayer, charity, what else?
So praying five times a day, giving charity, believing in one God. There's also, this is sort of optional, if you can afford it and you're healthy, you go for the pilgrimage where we actually commemorate Abraham when he was in Saudi Arabia, where we believe Abraham actually built, if you guys have ever seen a picture of that black cube that people are going around in circles,
yes.
We believe that Abraham built that. And if, I think in the Bible you have the same story around how Satan came and was, okay. Well, we believe that Abraham was asked to sacrifice one of his sons, and we sort of go through this commemoration, we reenact that whole process. And there's also, we believe that when...
Okay, you mean the sacrificing the goat thing?
Yeah.
Like Isaac?
Yeah.
Slash Ishmael?
Yes. Yeah.
That part is
okay.
But not the building of the Kaaba.
Yeah, so...
So let's go back to this Isaac slash Ishmael, because some of us, we're depending on Father Jamie's very cursory knowledge of world religions. It's my understanding that we're all Abrahamic faiths, which simply means that all of us, Christians, Jews, Muslims, what do we all have in common? We all trace our roots back to Abraham. You mentioned Israel, you mentioned Isaac slash Ishmael. Same person, different people, help us to understand.
So I actually want to answer your question, but I'm going to go back to the first question and talking about things that we have in common. We actually believe Adam and Moses and Jesus and Aaron, we believe in all of the same prophets. We believe that each prophet brought a message and then the next prophet basically progressed that same message, right? And so Abraham was given revelation and his children, right? He has two sons, Isaac and Ishmael, and both of them are given revelation. One, and I can never remember the name, but one of them is a lineage that Judaism comes from, right, and then Christianity comes out of that line. We believe that the other line, his other son, is where Muhammad's lineage is, and that's where Muslims come from. So when we talk about children of Abraham, right, that Jewish people are the people, who are the chosen people, the children of Abraham, for us there's no delineation between the progeny of both sons. Christians, Jews, and Muslims are all children of Abraham for us. And the stories are exactly the same. There might be a few differences, but the general flow and line is all the same. We believe in the original scripture that was revealed, the Psalms or the Torah. We believe in the original scripture that was revealed, I think it's Old Testament, right? We do believe over time that it has changed a little bit, and so it's not necessarily in its original form. And on that note, we also believe in Jesus being a prophet. The only thing we don't believe is that he is not, we believe he was a person, like every single other prophet, that he was a person. We do not believe he was crucified, and we actually believe that he will be coming back the same way that I think many believe that Jesus Christ will be coming back to defeat the Antichrist and unite all people under the same revelation. So a lot of the same thoughts, a little bit different interpretation. And we believe that Muhammad is the last messenger to basically pull all of that message together as a final message, but that Jesus comes back and preaches sort of the same stuff. And so, going back to your question, and Amanda, let me know if you want to add anything, around similarities and that lineage, is we believe, for example, with Moses and a lot of the things that he preached to the Jews, we feel like we have just as much connection to Moses and Aaron and a lot of these Jewish prophets. They are our prophets also. And we have a lot of the same instruction around fasting certain days and commemorating certain days, because that's also part of our tradition, the way that we look at it. And so I hope that answered your question.
Go for it, Rita.
Just a very basic question. Where did Muhammad, what part of the lineage, where did Muhammad fall in the lineage? Is there a generational lineage, or was he a prophet that just emerged and became more of the symbol of his religion? Can you explain that?
So like I said, I always forget, do you know, is it Isaac or Ishmael? I can't remember.
Ishmael.
So there's, I think, quite a few generations that passed between Ishmael and however many sons he had. I mean, there's quite a gap, right? And there were signs that, the way that we believe it, that were written in scripture, that like look for these signs, and that even there were a lot of holy people in Saudi Arabia at that time, whatever it was called, that recognized those signs, and we're recognizing that, okay, there's a prophet here, and a lot of whatever he believed, as he preached it and shared, a lot of people accepted it, and of course a lot of people didn't, right? And so I don't know exactly how many generations it was, but there was quite a gap.
But there is a lineage.
Yes.
Yeah, and I think also one of the things that's really important to understand about Islam is the circumstances and the culture in which Islam was revealed, right? And at that time, I mean, there had been generations of Arabs in ancient Arabia, Islamic Arabia, and they had adopted a lot of other beliefs. I mean, they did not stay true to monotheism. There were also, interestingly, Christians and Jews living in Arabia at that time, right? I mean, they had it was a very pluralistic culture, actually, which is one of the reasons why Muslims, now a lot of Muslims in America feel very comfortable in America, because originally Islam was in a very pluralistic society. And one of the things that Muhammad said when he brought the message of Islam was that he was there to call people back to this original monotheism. But what had happened at that time was, you know, the Kaaba that had been built originally by Abraham had been filled with idols, and Mecca at that time was a very large commercial place where traders would come all across the continent and stop there, and they would have their, it was considered like this sort of Vegas of worship. Like, there was all these different holy sites and altars and things all around the city, and people would come there and pay homage to all these different gods. And because of that, that's actually one of the reasons why there was pushback. When Muhammad brought the message about monotheism and said, we need to get rid of all this stuff, one of the reasons why there was a pushback and why they tried to kill him and get rid of Islam before it even got going was because he was challenging the kind of economic structure. He was saying, well, this whole city that's built on all these different people coming and worshiping all these gods, we can't have that. We have to go back to monotheism. And the people, the large tribes that controlled Mecca, who made a lot of money off of the tourist industry, were not happy about it. And so in that culture, there were, it was really an anything-goes kind of place. It was a very backward, very barbaric, very tribal culture in which women had no rights, there was slavery, there was all kinds of horrible it was a lot of, you know, infighting among the tribes, a lot of killing. It was not a civilized place. And so Muhammad came in with these ideas, and he came in with some radical ideas. When he said, you know, women have rights, and women have a right to get a divorce and have alimony, and women, you know, and you should respect your daughters, and instead of killing them, they were killing their baby daughters because they considered them a liability. And he came in with these radical ideas, and it just kind of freaked people out. They were like, this is insane. How can you try to change our culture? And he was literally trying to change the entire culture. And so that's one of the most, for me, fascinating things when I started learning about Islam. Because I love social justice, right? I mean, that's one of my biggest passions in life. And to have worked so many years in social justice, and if you do work in social justice, you know that progress is so slow, right? You take a few steps forward, you go back, and it's just this really slow thing. To have somebody come in to a backwards culture and revolutionize it within the lifetime of one man is miraculous. I mean, it's an amazing feat. And that was one of the most compelling things about Islam to me, is that this person came in and did away with all of this barbarism and brought in the rule of law that was based in faith in God, and did so in a way that was so compelling that it spread across the continent very quickly. This is a well-known story. I mean, there's people in American history who recognize this feat. I mean, if you go to the Supreme Court, Muhammad is carved into it, right? The founding fathers of this country, Thomas Jefferson had a copy of the Quran himself in his library. These are people that recognize this really amazing individual who transformed society and looked up to him. And that's part of how the founders viewed him, and how men throughout history and women throughout history have viewed Muhammad and the transformation that happened. So I think that that's a really important and compelling thing, because I don't think people understand, you know, we look back at our history and we can point and say, you know, Thomas Jefferson had slaves. He was a jerk. Right? Which is true, he did have slaves, and by our standards, by our modern standards, that's unacceptable. But if you look at it in the context of the time and place where he was a very progressive person, and he's one of the reasons why change, why this country was founded, and why it gave us this amazing framework. It's the same thing with Muhammad, right? And it's the same thing with every ancient faith tradition. You look back and I think by our standards that some of the stuff they were doing doesn't sound cool or kosher, but in the environment where they were and in the with the frameworks that they were working in, they were doing amazing things. And that's what we want to emulate, is not necessarily go back and try to recreate stuff thousands of years ago, but to emulate and try to practice that progressive mindset that's based in our faith and what's good for all of us and what's good for all people.
Sure.
No,
that was good.
It's 7:45 already, but we'd love to keep going with a few more questions here. At least three topics come to mind that we need to address while we have you in our midst. One, the way in which you're dressed differently. If you can help us to understand that and what beliefs underlie that, so that we better understand. Two, one of the images that we posted as part of the invitation to this, we posted a variety of images on our Facebook page to sort of pique people's interest. And one image was of a gentleman who was holding a poster saying, "All I needed to know about Islam, I learned on 9/11. Ouch. So maybe if we could just talk about the bad rap. That somehow everyone, you know, speaking from the Catholic tradition here, 2001 was a miserable time, especially for Catholic priests, because the sins of a few were falling on the men. I'm just imagining that in Islam it's a sort of similar phenomenon, if we can address that. And finally, we need to get to this word Islamophobia, because one of the other issues that we shared was of a young boy holding a poster saying, "I am a Muslim, don't hate me." Can you help to address at least those three issues?
Yeah.
going to start with number two.
Okay.
How did you guys, and this is my question to answer out loud, but just think about it, right? How did you guys feel after what happened in San Bernardino? How did you guys feel after what happened in Orlando, right? And how did you feel after Sandy Hook? Hold that for a moment. I'm 37 right now, and I remember when I was 11. So that's like, what, 20 some odd years ago. I was actually, my dad's a petroleum engineer, and I was living in Saudi Arabia, and that is when Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait, and Desert Storm happened. We've been bombing those countries since I was 11. So 20 years of being bombed, right? Not all those people were bad. I don't even know, let's just say 10% of them, if they were. And at that time, right, we didn't even know anything about terrorism. But those people who live in those countries, right, Iraq, Afghanistan, they've all been being bombed since then. Every day, living amongst that, going to school amongst that, trying to go to work, trying to get groceries. What kind of life do you live? You have no opportunity. And, you know, take what I'm saying with a little bit of grain of salt, right? But just try to imagine that, right? What if you're raising kids in that environment? What kind of life do they have? I'm going to rewind a little bit more, right? You guys learn about colonialism, right? About how England and Spain and Portugal went to all these countries and basically, you know, we fought as Americans against it. We kicked the British out. Yay! No more taxes. Boston Tea Party. Get the hell out of our country, right? But they were taking our resources, right? And taxing. And people here are working hard to make their own lives and they're giving all their money away, right? And maybe we celebrate this, but for the countries that, you know, colonialism was going on for the last 30, 40 years, right? Like, I'm Indian. My parents grew up in British India, where their resources, everything they were doing was pretty much getting stolen from them, right? Like, this country, everything that they had was taken and redirected to the British. And so what kind of opportunity did it have, right? And the British were there for how long saying, we're Britain, we're great, and then when Indians go to Britain, people are mad about it. It's like, well, you were in our country for 200 years telling us how great it was, and then when we show up, you don't want us here? Like, you know, and so there's a lot of different things at play in history, right? You can't forget that context, right? And so historically, countries, and I'm generalizing here, right? A lot of exploitment, right? A lot of opportunity taken. And then if every day you're living in this really tenuous environment where there's bombing, you have no idea what's going to happen, you have no control over your life, how your kids are going to school, your kids are growing up angry. And I heard this analogy once, like, you know, we, as Americans, we really love to root for the little guy, right? Like when you watch Star Wars, the rebels are fighting. And Hunger Games, right? The rebels are, they're banding together behind the Mockingjay, right? And I'm not saying it's okay, I'm not saying anyone's right or wrong, I'm just saying from the other point of view, a lot of these people, and this is not my words, I think I read this in, like, I don't know if it was The Box or New York Times or some legit publication went and interviewed these fighters who were captured, and they basically said, we feel like we're the rebels, that we're standing up to this big corrupt empire and fighting back. And that's how they view themselves. And sometimes it's just about history and who's got the point of view and how it's being told. Now, I'll just be very clear with you. I don't believe in terrorism. I don't believe in suicide bombing. I don't believe in any of that, nor is it part of my religion as far as I'm concerned. But some people feel like they're fighting. And then some people, you know, have... There's also corruption around it, right? Because a lot of times people will use religion as this bat to get people in line. And if they don't know better and they're hungry and they're angry, they're going to get in step behind anybody, right? And so I think religion's a really easy excuse to say, look at those people, they're bad because they're Muslim, without understanding the big picture. And that's sort of a very high-level way of answering question number two of, you know, everything I need to know about Islam I learned on 9/11, and I would say I hope that you can take a step back and look at the big picture, because at the end of the day, I'm a Muslim, and I was here, and I was attacked just like everybody else was. One thing Amanda did not mention is that I do a lot of work on the hate crimes task force because I've been a victim of hate crimes. And what I would tell you is, for people like ISIS, I'm an abomination myself. The fact that I'm a woman, that I work, that I go out of my home and I earn money and I take care of my family, the fact that I'm sitting here talking to you, it's not allowed. Whatever perverted version of Islam they follow is not our religion. It's just a construct they use to control people and wage a battle for whatever their greedy, power-hungry selves are doing. It has nothing to do with religion. Or my religion, I don't know, whatever they want to call it or label they have, I have nothing to do with it, right? And it's an attack on me and my family, just as much as it's an attack on you, right? And anybody else. And so I think that was an answer to question number two. You want to do number three, or should I go after why were my mentors? I forgot. If you remember.
I'm just imagining that when you dress a certain way, you know, you attract certain feelings and certain words and actions. I'm imagining that the way you dress at HEB makes you a different target for persons.
I'll tell you a funny story about that. Again, there's so much misinformation out there, and I'm going to tell a story and then I'll tell you why I wear this. But like, a lot of people think because I'm a Muslim, because I cover, that I'm really oppressed, right? I'm really oppressed, and that my husband has me like locked down, and anyways, lots of stereotypes. That's all good and fine. I was at the grocery store. I remember a couple. This was probably 2-3 years ago, and I have a daughter. She's 8 right now. When she was little, she loved music. I could take her to the mall, and you know how they just like pipe music in the stores? She would just be dancing, and we dance party. It doesn't matter where we are, right? Like if you're 3-year-old dancing, you dance with your 3-year-old, right? And so, you know, we're dancing, we're at HEB, and we're dancing. And I'm getting these stares, right? People walking by, double take, walking down, turning around, looking at us, and I'm like, what, haven't y'all seen a dance party before? Like, come on, like, you know, there's music on, right? And so I didn't realize it. My husband was going to go get some apples or something. He forgot, and he's like, I'll be right back. And apparently this lady had been following us around the store. I'm not paying attention. And as soon as my husband left, she goes, are you going to be okay? And I thought, I think so, is something wrong? She goes, I just had to stop you because your husband left. Are you going to be okay? Do I need to stay with you? And I thought, well, did he say something to you? Did he leave me? Like, where do you go, right? I was really confused. And she's like, no, but you're dancing in public. Like, is he going to go home and beat you? And I'm all like, what? You know, it took me a second to stop because all this stuff that's on TV or that you hear, right? Like, it's just become old news for me, and I shrug it off and I ignore it. But I just thought, wow, okay. And I stopped and I said, man, give you a hug. And she was like, okay, but are you going to be okay? I was like, I am. But I'm giving you a hug because, first, thank you for being concerned about me. But second, we're cool. Like, watch, my husband's gonna come back, I'm gonna introduce you to him, and we're just regular people, right? Like, this is just like the shirt. You put it on and you don't think about it for the rest of the day. That's all this is for me, right? And this is just like, you know, I think you guys believe that Mary, right, wears that covering, and that's all it is. People in the media have written this story that you guys have heard over and over. And I'm boring, right? I'm making school lunches and trying to figure out who's doing laundry and fighting for, okay, you go get the baby this morning because I want to sleep in, right? Like, we're just doing regular people stuff, and I don't get to be on the news because I'm boring. Nobody wants to hear from me, right? Only Crazy Town gets on the news, or like Jerry Springer, right? And she went, and I said, And she got a little embarrassed, but I said, that's why I gave you a hug, because I get that it's love, and I appreciate that, and thank you for taking care of me, and I hope at any time, you know, that you see injustice, that you speak out, because we believe in the same thing, and I really appreciate you for taking care of me, right? And, you know, it's a little funny story I tell, but at the end of the day, it's true that it's really easy to believe things about people, or really anyone, if they're far away from you, right? Like, even if it's something someone says about someone you know, and you don't know them that well, like, can you believe she said that? You have no reason. Okay, I guess she said it, right? And so I think it's incumbent on all of us to think, hey, is that really what happened? Do I really need to believe that? Like, come on. We're all smart at the end of the day, right? So, I'm just going to rewind then and go back to the original question. I started wearing a scarf, hijab, scarf, the terminology doesn't matter too much, when I was in college. But I'll tell you, I grew up not wearing one, and my parents always wanted me to, but they never forced me, because if any of you have kids, you already know that you can't tell your kids what to do very well. At least they'll do it in front of you. Sometimes they won't do it in front of you, right? But my parents always encouraged me, but they never made me. And where I was growing up, I grew up mostly in Houston, and there were two different kinds of girls that I saw wearing a scarf. And one type of girl was sort of maybe the equivalent of what you guys may call the preacher's daughter, right? Like, kind of do what you're supposed to do and then go wild when everybody's looking. And then the other type was a girl that was just like very, their families were really conservative or just maybe protective, and they did not let their daughters out. You know, these were my friends whose families were so conservative, the girls weren't allowed to drive, they weren't allowed to go anywhere if their mom and dad or older brother didn't go with them. I didn't really identify with either group. You know, I played varsity sports, honor society, debate, I mean, you know, beating my brother up since I was six, so I didn't identify, and I was like, God, I don't have anything to do with either of these groups of people. And my parents actually didn't explain religion to me very much. To be honest, I probably stayed on the straight and narrow, not because I believed in my religion, but because I loved my parents. And I thought, man, if I do that, I'm gonna hurt them. And so now it's just fun to tell people, like, yeah, I've never drank, because I never have, and people don't believe it. It's just kind of fun to be like, yeah, I never have. But growing up, I just didn't do it because it would hurt my parents, right? And so when I got to college, I went to UT to do my undergrad. I met girls who were really smart, really outspoken, just everything I was, way better, more inspiring, more amazing. Like, I felt like, like a black sheep compared to them, and they were doing all these amazing things and wearing their scarves, and it messed with my own stereotype, right? And I just thought, why are they wearing that? I don't understand. And so as I started to learn more about it, what I realized is that there's a few reasons that, for me, covering is important. And for me, I believe that in the Quran, which is like our Bible, we believe that it's a commandment that you should cover and be modest. But to me, it's important because as a woman, you should be respected for who you are, not what you look like. What you look like is nobody's business. Your value is who you are as a person in your class. And only if someone is willing to invest in your relationship do they have the choice of emotional and physical intimacy with you. But that is not anybody's thing to take. It is mine to give. If I could take this off right now if I wanted to have that emotional and physical intimacy with all of you in this room. This is just a physical construct of that value statement that, for me, I want you to see my thoughts, right? And that's all this is, an embodiment of that. For me, it's about respect. It doesn't matter how fat I am, or how skinny I am, or how big my assets are, or whatever. It's nobody's business unless I choose for it to be. And nobody else needs to have that to interact with me. So that's what, for me, it means. And I find that to be not only beautiful, but really empowering. Really, really empowering. I love that I feel no pressure to look any way or be anything other than who I am. And it doesn't stop me from anything, right? Like, I've run marathons wearing my scarf, right? I'm a senior manager at a blue chip firm. It doesn't stop me. And actually, in a sense, wearing my religion on my sleeve helps me know where I stand with people. Because I'm like, okay, like, I don't have to figure out what you think about me because I can see it on your face. Good to know, right? And so that's sort of what it is for me. And I'll tell you, I have an 8-year-old daughter. We talk about it all the time. And it's not something I'm going to force on her. I want her to choose to wear it. And, you know, I'm not going to lie. There's a lot of cultures and places where it is forced on women. But that's culture. It has nothing to do with religion, right? Just the way that you guys know, religion's in your heart. Nobody can put it there or force it on you, right? And I think it's an abomination when anything. And so, did that answer your question, Father?
Sure.
I guess you get Islamophobia.
So, just to summarize that, just this whole thing of Islamophobia, then, we know that history was made here in Central Texas last night. Last night, we elected our first ever Muslim American in Central Texas to elect an office. I don't know if you followed that news. It's a big day. But on the other hand, you know, at the national level, we have a president-elect who has said something about Muslims. Which, if he said something about Catholics in the same way, I have a feeling we as Catholics would be like, what? We would all be, we'd be beside ourselves. So can you just tell us the state of Islam in the United States, and especially what it is that people like us can do to be better allies, better brothers and sisters?
Sure. So I think with the word Islamophobia, is not something that I think is universally appreciated. I think there are, even within the Muslim community, some people dislike it. But the fact is that there is this irrational distrust, hatred, and paranoia about Muslims that has to have an end for the sake of us being able to talk about it. And so Islamophobia is where we find it at this point. Muslims are about 2% of the total population of this country. I think a recent Pew study said that less than 20% of Americans can say that they know any Muslims. Because of that, there's a huge amount of ignorance. And I mean ignorance in the classical sense. People simply don't know. They don't know Muslims, they don't understand who we are. The only information they get comes from
Fox News.
News that is, super inflammatory. And from people who have a political agenda, who want to leverage the distrust of Muslims. And there are, this is documented, well documented, that there are people out there who literally, that's what they do, they generate information online that is hateful toward Muslims. Yes, yes. Now the thing is, I think as a white person, I feel pretty comfortable speaking to this. Yes, I understand the fear that a lot of people in this country have about Muslims. I can tell you, I was a Muslim on the 11th, and I saw what happened, and it shook me and made me terrified. It terrified me. That's why they did it, to terrify us, right? And here you have these men who are claiming Islam as the reason for doing this terrible thing. And this is not an isolated incident. There's other terrorists who have done bad things in the name of Islam, who are claiming that my religion, that our religion, is the basis for doing evil, evil things to our fellow Americans. And so yes, I understand. I understand that if all you know about Muslims is that what you've seen in the news, the statements from terrorists, then yes, you are going to be you're not going to trust us, and I don't like this, and you're going to have all these crazy ideas, and all it will take is a little bit of misinformation to help you build a case about why Muslims don't belong here and why Muslims are, you know, antithetical to America. Which is why we do what we do. All we can ask from you guys, from people that we meet in the community, is to keep in mind that we are as representative, if not more, of America's Muslims, and probably Muslims around the world, than any terrorist ever was or ever will. Right? The majority of Muslims, myself and Luna included, are American in this country. We are born and raised, born and raised here, and raising our families, we own houses, we pay taxes, we volunteer, we do the whole thing, right? We have kids in school, we are your average American. We listen to hip hop, we even rap. Right? Like it's just to try, it becomes very exhausting for Muslims to keep trying to convince people that we're normal. But that's really where we are. That's where we are. So going out and trying to convey that to people. And so our only ask is that you recognize that this is something that every minority group in this country has had to deal with at some point. There's always going to be somebody that has a stake in demonizing a minority group, right? Whether it's an ethnic minority, a religious minority, any kind of minority. If someone can get elected by pointing to that group and saying, these people are bad and trying to get you and I'm going to protect you, they will do it, right? So if you know that, if you know that that's true about other groups, then you must know that it's true about our group, and you must be willing to give us the benefit of the doubt. And that's all we can ask, is the benefit of the doubt for all of us. That yes, yeah, there are bad Muslims. There are horrible, bad, bad people who are Muslim, who do bad things. And some of them are in this country, and some of them are American Muslims. And if you want, I can go out tomorrow and find you Muslims that hate America. But I can also go out there and find Muslims that love America, right? Don't generalize about the entire group based on whatever it is that agrees with your preconceived notions. Allow us to get to know us on a level of, I guess, a granular level where you recognize that there are so many different pieces to who each of us are, right? Whether some of it's our religion and our gender and our sexuality and our the way we practice and our politics, and all of us have these different things. All we want to do is be considered in the same way that anyone else is, right?
Like any other group of people.
Like any other group of people. And that's probably my only ask. But the idea that Islamophobia is what we're fighting right now, there are absolutely people in this country that are trying to use Muslims for their own, to mistreat Muslims for their own benefit. It's
mental.
I can't stress to you how difficult it is to live in an environment like this, especially to raise children in an environment like this, where they literally will walk into the room and there on our big TV screen are men and women saying things about Muslims that are so insulting to me as an American, right? Not just as a Muslim, but as an American. And to have to go through that with your children. Children are 13, they're smart, and they understand the world now, and they're confused. They don't understand why people on TV are saying to them, they're Minecraft and McDonald's. Like, they are American kids. They do not understand why anyone would hate us. And so, for us trying to be in this environment, we would also ask maybe a little bit of empathy and patience, because we are a minority. We don't have a huge amount of people. We don't have a lot of money. We don't have a lot of, you know, infrastructure. We don't have big whatevers. You know, we don't have big hospitals. And I mean, Catholics have been around in this country for so long, and there's beautiful cathedrals everywhere, and there's hospitals, and there's, you know, all this infrastructure. We have none of that as Muslims at this point in history. We are just still mostly immigrants, and we're all still trying to just survive. And most of the people who are Muslim are just trying to like earn their living, raise their kids, and stay out of trouble. And so it is, you know, Luna and I feel a kind of a burden as natural born Muslims and as people who are comfortable with the language and with the culture to kind of stand in front a little bit and take some of the heat so that our friends and relatives, you know, my mother-in-law who's in her 60s who immigrated here from Pakistan as an adult, I mean, the idea of somebody like harassing her at Walmart makes me want to lose my mind. Like, why? Right? So we have that role where we have to step out in front, but it's not an easy thing, and even for people that are tough like us, and we are tough, it's exhausting and burdensome. So understanding that would be.
Doesn't matter all the rest of the mess that's going on, right?
And so, first, did I answer your question? I think that most people, right, who are truly religious have these basic tenets, right, around honesty and kindness, golden rule, all this stuff you learned in kindergarten, right? To backtrack on what I was saying is that we actually have a friend who worked for a think tank, and they basically did this study and followed all of the money, right, around people who whip up this fear, Islamophobia, anti-Muslim bigotry, whatever you want to call it. It is actually an industry. There are a select few people that peddle this hate and fear in media, right? Newsprints, interviews, things like that. It's actually a handful of folks. There's a gajillion dollars that pours into them to peddle this information, and it goes back to a handful of organizations. And if anyone is interested in the data, that report is called Fear, Inc. Fear, Inc., you can Google it and read it. And it basically outlines who the people are that peddle this stuff and the fear that they really push out there. And if you follow the money, you'll understand what the agenda is around that, right? At the end of the day, it's about who benefits. And my ask, if I were to say, you know, what I would like people to do is check your facts. Check your facts, look for legitimate information. If you see people posting stuff on Facebook, where did that come from? What is that? Can you help me understand? And I have this feeling that when you double click once or twice or three times, then you can figure out, yeah, you know, like anyone, again, if you're a parent, you have that, like, that sniff test. A lot of this stuff isn't going to pass the sniff test, right? And just go look at credible pieces of information. And, you know, I hope that at the end of the day, if you're not sure, we're always here as resources for you to ask. And so I would say don't give us the benefit of the doubt. Find out. Do your own homework. And I feel really comfortable that you're going to land in the right place. I don't want anyone giving me the benefit of the doubt if I haven't earned it. I'm not going to give that to a stranger. And I'm just so confident in knowing what my religion says and what we preach and what we do that I'm not worried about it, right? But that if you guys are listening, and you feel like we're credible people, then I think I don't have to ask you that. Hopefully you're already gonna do it, okay? And so I hope that not just for Muslims, but for all of us, I wanna thank you so much for inviting us, because I think this is what makes Austin so beautiful, is that we are building our own community. We decide what's important to us, what kind of city we wanna be, what kind of people that we want to be, and how we define our home, and we don't. I don't want there to be any lines, whether it's Muslims or illegals, those blacks, the gays. I don't know what you believe, but at the end of the day, we're all human. Like you said, we all put our pants on one leg at a time, right? Everybody is fighting a battle every day, and to me, that's the ask, right? That like we're just compassionate with each other, because that's the world I want my child to grow up in. And I think we all have the ability to do that in all of our everyday interactions. And I believe that's my faith, but I believe that's also your faith.
Just one quick response to the ISIS question. I think that there is Islam is a tradition with a long history of scholarship, and that isn't just any old person just can pick up the Quran and say this is what we believe. And there's schools of thought that are thousands of years old, and it is a very legalistic tradition. And in order to get to a certain point, it's very much like Judaism. In order to actually get to a certain legal ruling, you might have to be schooled in it. It's not just like, hey, I'm going to read this verse in the Quran and do it. And so, that being said, most mainstream scholars disavow what's done with the name of ISIS, and most mainstream scholars disavow terrorism. And you will find the occasional nutbag who's on YouTube saying stuff. That person, you know, maybe to you, you don't know anything about Islam or Muslims or the Muslim world. They might look credible to you because they have a beard, but the reality is that these are not real scholars, right? These are just people that are saying what they want to say and trying to whip people up. So that's an important point. I think there is absolutely a beautiful institutionalized study of Islam, both religiously and academically, and you won't find support for what ISIS does anywhere.
Why are people so afraid of having an answer for Sharia law? Is there a simple response?
Sharia law is basically, Sharia just means law. And so it's, I don't know, to me it's such a like absurd thing for people to be afraid of, because it's like saying we can't get married religiously, or you know, like, I'm not supposed to give 2.5% of charity every year. Like, those are just, I'm living it every day. It's been here, right? Like, 30% or 1/3 of the slaves that came to this, you know, country were Muslims who were brought over here. Islam has been here since, you know, for 200 years. Anyone who practices religion does it every day. It's already here. I don't know what people are afraid of. It's like, not this boogeyman.
I always wondered that was such a big issue.
So last year, the year before, during the legislative session, they actually brought laws where they were trying to say you can't have foreign law, right? That's how they get around calling it anti-Muslim law. They say we want an anti-foreign law bill. And so what that's saying is that Islam and the Sharia, which is our tradition, same as Kashrut in Jewish tradition, it can't apply here. But what that does is it means that if somebody is married Islamically and they want an Islamic divorce, the rights that women have in an Islamic divorce are actually better for them financially than the laws of Texas. And so what it's saying is, you can't have an Islamic divorce if you get a divorce, or you can't have an Islamic whatever. It's a lot of family law. So what was interesting is actually had hearings where rabbis and Catholic leadership came in and testified, because it's the same thing with the Catholics too, right? Like, you have a foreign laws that govern your family courts, right? And it's the same exact thing. It's the same exact thing that people have made it into
just this boogeyman.
Yeah, it's a bizarre thing. Yeah.
Amanda, Luna, thank you both for being here. Wow.